Dear learner, namaskar. I am Dr. Azmat Noori, and today my topic of discussion is understanding of Indian history. The topic is going to be how do I know what happened in the past and how does it help me to understand what is happening today. Apparently, what is happening today, for example, all innovations in the field of art, architecture and culture has its roots in the past. So let's start with what is history. History is the study of past events. It helps us to understand those processes that enable the early humans to successfully conquer their environment and develop the present-day civilization. It is not just a study of battles and kings, as is normally understood by some. It is an analysis of society, economy, and cultural trends over a long period and asks questions as to why certain events happened and what was their impact on society at large. Every new evidence or a fresh interpretation of existing evidence by different scholars help us in enriching our knowledge about the past. A historian differentiates between fact and fiction. However, myths, which are based on oral tradition of a society, may contain memories of past happenings. The historian's job is to ascertain the fact through cross-checking of different historical evidence. In this discussion, you will learn how India's ancient past was constructed with the help of large varieties of historical evidence and their interpretation. Before going further, let me tell you about the objectives of this lesson, and the objectives are to understand historical construction of India's ancient past, know about various type of source material used by ancient historian, and identify changing tradition of history writing. Let's start with the first objective, that is sources for reconstructing ancient Indian history. A historian needs source material to reconstruct the past, but sources themselves do not reveal the past. They need interpretation, and the historian makes them speak. In fact, the historian is expected to track the source, read texts, follow clues, ask relevant questions, cross-check evidences to offer meaningful explanation. For example, in 1826, Charles Mason noticed the high walls and towers of an old settlement in Harappa village of western Punjab, now in Pakistan. 5 decades later, Sir Alexander Cunningham collected some seal from this site, but it took archaeologist John Marshall another 50 years to identify the oldest civilization in the Indus region. I shall give another example regarding the historian's task to cross-check different types of evidences. In the sources pertaining to King Harsh, 7th century AD, we find a mention of his defeat at the hands of Chalukya ruler Pulkeshin II. But one of the inscriptions of Pulkeshin II claim a victory over Harsh. In this case, it is obvious that Harsha's biographer Banbhat, who wrote Harshcharita, deliberately did not mention the defeat of his patron. One reason for this could be that Banbhat received patronage from the King Harsh. Earlier historians used myth, fiction and oral tradition in a limited way on account of their lack of authenticity and verifiability. But today, these unconventional sources are being used innovatively. Written material can be verified, cited and cross-checked, while oral evidences, for example, myths and folk songs, were never considered a valid source. The sources of history is conventionally divided into two categories, that is literary and archaeological. Literary sources includes all text, long and short, written or oral. Archaeological sources includes all tangible materials remains. Let's start with literary sources. Most ancient Indian texts contain religious themes, and these are known as Vedas. The Vedas are 4 in number. The Rig Veda, the Sam Ved, the Yajur Ved, and the Athar Ved contain prayers, rituals, magic, and mythological stories. The Upanishads contain philosophical discussion on Atma and Paramatma. They are also referred to as a Vedanta. The two epics Ramayana and Mahabharata seem to have finally compiled by 400 AD. The Mahabharata is attributed to sage Vyas. It originally consisted of 8,800 verses and called Jayagit. These later got expanded to 24,000 verses and came to be known as Bharat because it contained the stories of the descendants of one of the earliest Vedic tribes called Bharat. A further expanded version of 1 lakh verses was named Mahabharat. Similarly, the Ramayana of Valmiki originally consisted of 6,000 verses, then 12,000 verses, and was finally expanded to 24,000 verses. In the post-Vedic period, we have recorded a large number of ritual literature on moral, values called sutra. Grand public sacrifice to be performed by rulers are recorded in Swat Sutra, while domestic rituals connected with birth, naming, sacred thread ceremony, marriage, funerals, etc. are prescribed in Grihasutra. This literature was compiled between 600 to 300 BC. The religious books of the Jain and Buddhist refer to historical persons and incidents connected with their respective religions. The earliest Buddhist texts were written in Pali. They are called Tripitaka, that is, Sutpitaka, Vinayapitaka, Abhidhammapitaka. The most important non-religious Buddhist literature are the Jatakas. They contain the stories of the previous birth of the Buddha. It was believed that before he was actually born as Gautama, the Buddha passed through over 550 births. Each birth story is called Jataka. These stories throw invaluable lights on the social and economic condition of the people between the 5th and 2nd century BC. The Jain texts were written in Prakrit and were eventually compiled in 6th century AD at Vallabhi in Gujarat. They are called Ang and contain the philosophical concept of Jains. Now, we will discuss secular literature. This category of literature does not have religion as its theme. To this class belongs the Dharma Shastra or the law book, which prescribe duties for different social groups. They set out punishment for persons guilty of theft, murder, adultery, etc. The earliest law book is Manusmriti. It was the first book translated by the British and formed the basic of Hindu code of law. Arthashastra of Kautilya provides rich material for the study of Indian economy and polity of the modern period. Works on grammar are also sometimes useful for historical reconstruction. The earliest and the most important work on grammar is the Ashtadhayi, written by Panini, which is dated by a scholar around 700 BC. The work of Kalidas, who lived during the Gupta period, comprised poems and dramas. The famous among them are Abhigyan Shakuntalam, Ritu Sahar, Meghdoot. Besides being great creative composition, they provide us with glimpse of the social and cultural life of the Guptas. For the history of Kashmir, we have an important book called Raj Tarangni, written by Kalhan in 12th century AD. Biographies are very important non-religious texts for writing history. They were written by court poet in praise of their patron rulers, as there is a tendency among them to exaggerate the achievement of the patron. They have to be studied with caution. One such important text is Harshcharitra, written by Banabhat in praise of Harshvardhana. The earliest South Indian literature is called Sangam literature. It was written in Tamil and is secular in nature. It was produced by poet who joined together in assemblies, that is Sangam, patronized by chief and king during the first four centuries of the Christian era. Their literature consists of short and long poems in praise of various heroes, written probably to be recited in the courts. The Sangam literature is our major source for the study of South Indian society, economy and polity during 300 BC to 300 AD. The description given in the Sangam literature are confined by archaeological finds and accounts of foreign travelers. Inscriptions were another very important source of information for constructing history. Inscriptions are permanent writing engraved on hard surface such as stone, metal or terracotta. Study of inscription is called epigraphy. The earliest inscriptions were written on stone. They usually recorded the achievement, activities and ideas of those who got them inscribed. So we get inscriptions which glorify the exploits of king or mention domination made by men and women for religious purposes. Those inscriptions which are composed by poets in praise of king and patron are known as prasthis. Some inscriptions carry dates, others are dated on the basis of paleography or style of writing with a fair amount of precision. The earliest inscriptions were in Prakrit, a name for a language used by ordinary people. In later time, Tamil and Sanskrit were also used to write inscriptions. The modern king Ashoka was the first person to issue inscriptions. Most of his inscriptions are in Prakrit language, written in Brahmi and Kharosthi. The Aramaic and Greek script were used for inscription in Afghanistan so that the local people could understand their subject matter. The Brahmi script was first deciphered in 1837 by James Prinsep, who was a civil servant during the British rule. Brahmi was written from left to right, like Hindi, while Kharosthi from right to left. Ashokan inscriptions help us in understanding his religious and administrative policies. From the 1st century BC, the kings started granting lands for religious purposes. Satavahanas, kings of the Deccan, were the first one to do so. These inscriptions recorded the consents granted to the Doni. Such inscriptions help us in finding out the religious and economic activities of the period. Some of these inscriptions are written on stone, but most on copper plates. However, there are some limitations of inscriptional evidence. For example, sometimes letters are faintly engraved, and thus reconstruction are uncertain. Also, inscription may be damaged or letters missing. Besides, it is not always easy to be sure about the exact meaning of the word used in inscription, some of which may be specific to particular place or time. The study of coins is known as numismatic. It not only includes visual elements such as script and image on the coins, but also metallurgical analysis. Ancient coins were mostly minted in metals such as copper, silver, gold, and lead. The earliest coins found in India contained certain symbol and were called panchmark coin. They were made of silver and copper. The first coin to bear the name and images of rulers were issued by Indo-Greeks, who established control over the northwestern part of the subcontinent. The first gold coins were issued by the Kushanas in 1st century AD. Some of the most spectacular gold coins were issued by the Gupta rulers. Their earliest issues are remarkable for their purity of gold content. Coins provide useful information regarding economic history, as they were used as a medium of exchange. Some coins were issued by guilds or association of the merchants and craftsmen with the permission of the rulers. This shows the influence of crafts and commerce. Coins also portray kings and gods and contain religious symbols and throw light on the art and religion of the time. The material remains of the past can be studied with the help of archaeology. Archaeology is a science that enables us to systematically dig the successive layers of old mounds and to form an idea of the material life of the people of the past on the basis of remains found there. Archaeology is very important to study prehistory. For example, the period before the invention of writing, history is basically based on written material. Although writing was known in India by 2500 BC in the Indus culture, its script has not so far been deciphered. Thus, although Harappan knew how to write, but historians have not been able to read it. Their culture is placed in the period called proto-historic phase. First script to be deciphered was Brahmi, which was used in the Ashokan inscription and belongs to the 3rd century BC. The excavation sites belonging to the Harappa period show the layout of the settlements and the form of the houses in which people lived. In South India, some people were buried along with their tools, weapons, and other belongings under big and heavy stone. These graves are known as megaliths. By digging them, we learn about the life of people who lived in the Deccan and South India before the 3rd century BC. The remains found in many excavation sites are fixed by various methods. The most important of them is the radiocarbon or carbon-14 dating method. Carbon-14 is a radioactive carbon present in all living objects. It decays like all radioactive substances at a uniform rate when the object is dead. By measuring the loss of carbon-14 contained in an ancient object, wood or bone, its age can be determined. The history of climate and vegetation is known through an examination of plant residues and especially through pollen analysis. On this basis, it is suggested that agriculture was practiced in Kashmir and Rajasthan around 7000 to 6000 BC. The nature and components of metal artifacts can also be analyzed scientifically, and consequently the mines from which metals were obtained are located and stages in the development of metal technology identified. The geological studies provides an idea of the history of soil, rocks, etc., where prehistoric man lived. Human history cannot be understood without an idea of the continuing interaction between soil, plants, and animals on one hand and humans on the other. Taken together with archaeological remains, geological and biological studies act as an important source for the reconstruction and development of human history. Indigenous literature can be supplemented by foreign accounts. To India came Greek, Roman, and Chinese visitors, either as ambassadors or travelers, or to seek religious knowledge from time to time. They have left behind an account of the things they saw. To the court of Chandragupta Maurya came a Greek ambassador called Megasthenes, who wrote Indica. Its original text is lost, but parts of it have been preserved in fragments quoted by subsequent Greek writers. When Read together, these fragments furnish valuable information not only about the administration but also social classes and economic activities of the modern period. Greek and Roman accounts of the 1st and 2nd century mention many Indian ports and commodities of trade between India and the Roman Empire. Pericles of the Arethian Sea and Ptolemy's Geography, both written in Greek, provide valuable data in this regard. Of the Chinese travelers, mention may be made of Fayan and Huangshang. Both of them were Buddhist and came to this country mainly to visit the Buddhist shrine and to study Buddhism. Fayan, who came to India in the 5th century AD, described the condition in India in the age of Guptas, whereas Huangshang presents a similar account of India in the 17th century during the time of King Harshvardhan. Huangshang also described in details the glory of Nalanda University during this period. It was suggested, particularly by a Western scholar, that ancient Indians had no sense of writing history. But it is not true. Actually, Indians' sense of writing history was different from that of the Westerns. The people from the West recorded events in chronological order, while the ancient Indians wrote in a different manner. It can be seen in the text called the Puranas, where four different ages called Krita, Treta, Draupa, and Kali are mentioned. And in each age, we get detailed list of rulers and dynasties, beside a large number of inscriptions have been discovered. These give genealogies of kings of various dynasties and also refers to their achievements. It shows that Indians had basic knowledge of time and space where events were taking place. In 1904, B.A. Smith wrote Early History of India. It was the first systematic history of ancient India. In this book, his approach to history was pro-British and he tried to justify the British rule in India. It served as good propaganda material for the perpetuation of despotic British rule. This brings me to the end of my discussion on the sources of ancient Indian history. Thank you.